Hey guys, my name is Michael and thank you for checking out this video. So I want to talk about the different apps in SetApp, which I think are possibly worth the money for that subscription fee. Now, SetApp, for those who don't know, is a membership-based service where you can go sign up and get access to a whole bunch of different Mac apps and iOS apps that are normally paid apps, but you get those as part of your subscription. So you can download them and install them or remove them at will. And all you have to pay is just that membership fee every month. So for many people, it's worth it. And just like with any other membership, there are apps in there that I think are really, really good and possibly worth the money for that subscription. And other apps that I think are just, you know, they're okay. They're not like something I would go buy, but it's nice to have them available in that membership if you want them. So what I want to do is highlight some of the apps that I think are really good and maybe help you decide if SetApp is worth it for you. So let's take a look. So this app is really kind of nostalgic for me in many ways. And back in 2007 and 2008, I had a MacBook Pro that I really, really liked. And that's probably one of my favorite computers that I've ever used, even up to today. And I've used lots of computers ever since then, of course, but this app is called iStat Menus. And the reason I like this app is it would put things in the Finder bar for me. So I could see my RAM usage, my CPU utilization, GPU, how much storage I have left, all some cool stuff. Now, being a geek, I like to see that kind of stuff there at a glance. Now, of course, I can open up Activity Monitor and stuff, which is no problem, but I like to have that there for me in one, that's one visual interface to see, which is just kind of fun. But it's now a paid application and it's also now part of the SetApp subscription. So you can go buy it in, on its own if you want to, or you can get SetApp and have it included here, which is pretty cool. So what it will do is it will put something up here in the Finder bar. So you can see something like your CPU usage, your memory, how much storage you've used or how much is free. But, however you want to configure that. So I can see that I've got about 8.5 gigabytes free on my Mac, which is pretty good out of 1 terabyte in considering what I use my Mac for. So that's pretty good. Now there's a network graph there, which, you know, has limited use, but I think it's kind of cool and kind of fun to watch that as it goes. Now, what I really like about this particular app is it does show me the various sensors that are built into macOS here, into my MacBook Pro here. So I can see, for example, the temperature of the airport sensors or airflow and battery and all these cool things. Now, these are sensors that Apple puts into the Mac so that the system knows that no portion of the system is getting too warm. So we know that heat is bad for computers, right? We know that if any portion of the system gets too hot for too long, it can damage it. So the system needs to keep an eye on those things and know that, say, if, for example, the memory module is getting too warm, then the whole system has to throttle back performance to cool that part down so that it's not damaged. And if someone is having performance issues with a Mac, then one of the first things that I'm going to recommend that we check after we do just a general system cleanup is how are the temperatures? And if the temperatures are getting too hot on any one of these points, then we know we have a problem. Now, that could be something as simple as the fans need to be cleaned out, or it could be something like maybe you're using it on a soft surface that shouldn't be used on, or there could be something else going on like a faulty sensor or something else internally maybe on the board that's going bad. So this is a good thing to keep an eye on. Now, not obsessively, of course, but if you're curious, then it's there for you, which is kind of cool. And I could also see how fast or how slowly my fans are spinning, if at all, because being an M1 MacBook Pro here, or M1 Pro, MacBook Pro, there are times where the fans don't even spin, which is kind of cool, but it's kind of fun to watch that. Now, you can also customize a lot of this to your heart's content. I've got mine set to show in this combined view, which is the option down here at the bottom on this left column. But if I wanted to have these show me, let's say I want to see the memory and my CPU usage up here in the menu bar, but I don't want that combined view, then I don't have to have that, and I can separate that out. But personally, I like to have this combined view because I don't want to have all of this stuff taking up so much space on my bar up here. And you can see how much space it can take up, of course, which is quite a bit. But having that one combined view, I can just click on that one little button and it shows me everything, which is pretty cool. But that's iStat Menus. It's part of SetApp now. I like it a lot. Maybe you will too. So if you've ever accidentally deleted something and you realize, I didn't mean to delete that, what do I do? Well, you might appreciate this particular app, which is called Disk Drill. And Disk Drill is a pretty cool program because it will look through your SSD and try to recover data that it can. So it will scan your complete SSD and try to reconstruct data as best it can, and then give you the option to save it somewhere else if it's recoverable. Now, do be aware that there is a point at which a file stored on an SSD will no longer be recoverable if it's been too long, because what happens is garbage collection or trim. And after a while, when macOS says to the SSD, hey, the user is deleting this file, go ahead and mark that as gone. Eventually the SSD is going to say, okay, and then zero that out, all the places where that file was stored on the physical SSD. So when that happens, it's no longer possible to recover that file. But if you get to this process before that happens, then something like Disk Drill might actually be able to recover the file for you, which is pretty cool. And this is included with SetApp. So it will show me things like, how likely is it that I would be able to recover the file, or is it possible that the file has been overwritten and maybe it's not recoverable anymore? So there's a chance that it could see the file and see that, yeah, it was there, but we can't really do anything for you. But this program will give you a good option or a good chance at getting it back. But pretty cool. Now, one thing I do like about this app is it does have some other cool features in it. So for example, we can look at iPhones and iPads, or we can look at Android or Time Machine backups even. So if you know there's something in your Time Machine backup and you want to scan that, then go for that. But here's some other cool stuff as well. So there's a smart monitoring option. So I can look and see, well, how healthy is my SSD and my Mac? Now we know that solid-state drives do have a limited lifespan, and I want to know, well, is my SSD in good shape? So I can see here that for this particular computer, it's at 100%, which is good, and that's about what I would hope for on this computer, considering its age. But over time, that will go down, and I will need to, you know, keep an eye on that. So this is one cool tool to be able to do that. Now, one thing that I think is pretty cool with this app is the ability to create a Mac OS installer. And if you've ever been traveling and you've ever needed to reinstall Mac OS for any reason, maybe Mac OS isn't working, or you are just having lots of kernel panics, or just whatever the case might be, or maybe you just want to have an installer as a backup, this program will actually let you create a USB installer of Mac OS to keep on hand. So you can keep that in your backpack with you, or you can keep it at your desk if you ever needed it. So yes, Mac OS does have a recovery built into it, so you can actually boot into recovery on your Mac and do that if you wanted to. But what happens if that doesn't work? What if your internet doesn't work, or your internet's not reliable? Maybe you're traveling and you don't want to use the hotel Wi-Fi. Well, you can have that USB installer of Mac OS with you and install Mac OS without having to use the internet, except once you're finally at the end of the setup process, which is pretty cool. And I like that feature a lot. Now, there is one other cool thing here that I want to point out with this app, and that is the cleanup function. Now, if you've ever been low on storage and you want to know, well, where's all my storage going? What's using up all my space? This program will show you what's using all your space. So it will do a scan of the SSD and see, for example, right now on my 1 terabyte SSD, most of my space is going to applications, which makes sense. I mean, that's where I would expect it to go. So, you know, Xcode is using just under 24 gigs, which is quite a bit of space, but it's good to know that if I uninstalled Xcode, I would be saving about 24 gigs of space. So this is a pretty cool bonus feature of this application, which you might find useful if you are someone who might have a smaller SSD in your Mac and you want to make sure that you are maximizing how much space you have available. So pretty cool. That's Disk Drill. I like it a lot. Check it out. Now, this next tool might be a little bit controversial, not because of what it is or what it can do, but because of what it's named. Now, Gifox, or Gifox, depending on your pronunciation, and that's kind of a battle in and of itself, but Gifox is a pretty cool tool for recording your screen and saving it as a GIF or a GIF, depending on how you pronounce the word. But what I like about this is it makes it very easy to do a quick recording of the screen without having to upload it as a video and saving it maybe on YouTube or whatever file sharing system you want to use. So I can upload this, say, to Reddit, or, you know, as part of a Medium article, all pretty cool stuff. So all I would have to do is hit Command, Shift, and 6 and drag a window around what I want to record. And you can see that it gives me this interface here with a record button on here and a couple of other preferences options. So if I hit record here, then I will go ahead and switch between these various tabs and record some video, and I can change the keyboard shortcut there as well if I don't like the Command Shift 6 option. And then I'll click on stop and give it a moment to process, and it shouldn't take too long here. But what's cool about this is there are times when you might want to embed a little demo of something on your website or in an article or in a post of some sort without having to upload a video, and this is pretty cool. So you can see here that on my desktop now, there is a GIF of what I just did, and I can then share this or email it or whatever I want to do with it, which is pretty cool. So that's Gifox, or Gifox, Don't at me. It's something. So this next program might be a little bit polarizing depending on your preferences. Some people like this program and some people think it's terrible, but personally, I like it. I think it's done a pretty good job for me personally, but that program is CleanMyMac X. Now, this is a program that I've used to do some cleanups on the system and just running, making sure that it's running as it should. You know, it is a paid program, so I don't know that I would pay for it independently, but having it as part of the subscription does make that subscription a little bit more enticing for me. And if I do the smart scan, you can see that it's looking at things that it can clean up. So any junk and unneeded files for me. And then it's also going to do a quick scan for malware, make sure that there's nothing there that's concerning. And it will also do a quick scan to see what it can do to speed up the system for me, which is nice. And if I click on this review details button, then I can see that there are cache files, log files, you know, those things which are not harmful, but over time those build up. And this is true on both Windows and macOS. Over time, those build up and they can cause a bit of a performance loss if they just get too much and they, of course, do take up space. You can see I'm losing about 3.43 gigabytes of space from my Mac just with log files. So I would like to get rid of those if I can, which I can. So that's kind of cool. Now I'm going to go ahead and stop this and then we'll move on. Now, if I know that I want to get rid of system junk in particular, what I can do is go directly to that section and then click on scan. And it will do a quick scan just like it did previously. And it will tell me what it can do to remove junk. And click on review details here. Then I can see again, those same cache files, system cache files, universal binaries. Now universal binaries are bits of code that are included with programs that you download that will work for both Apple Silicon and for Intel. So for example, you might have an Apple Silicon Mac, but for someone who has an Intel Mac, well, they need code that will work on that architecture, right? But the developer doesn't know what kind of Mac you have. So they're going to include code both for Apple Silicon and for Intel and put them together so that no matter what kind you have, their app will work. Well, depending on what you have, you may not need one or the other. So for example, on mine, I don't need the Intel code because I have an Apple Silicon Mac running the M1 Pro chip. So the Intel code will no longer be of no use to me. So I can get rid of that. Or if you have an Intel Mac, then you don't need the ARM code on your programs. So using this, you can go through and get rid of those unnecessary universal binaries and free up some space, which is kind of nice, especially if you are running low in space and you want to save every bit that you can. So kind of cool. And of course, there is a malware removal section here. Now, Macs do get infected, so don't get complacent here. So I want to tell you about this real quick. So I've seen so many Macs over the years that have been infected with various things. Now, nowhere as bad as I would see on a Windows system necessarily, but I have seen Macs with malware, so don't get complacent. If you don't want to use this, there are other antivirus programs out there for Mac. You know, Malwarebytes is pretty good, and there are, you know, others like Bitdefender, which is also pretty good, but make sure that you are protecting yourself, okay? So this program will do that. It will scan for some malware programs and make sure that they're removed. You can also do things like making sure that your browsers are cleaned out. So any cookies, things that you want to get removed so they're not, you know, just lurking there. It's good. It's good to do as well. So various optimization tasks, maintenance. Now, I do like the fact that this does have an uninstaller in it. So macOS's way to uninstall programs by dragging them to the trash, it's really not great. I mean, you can leave a lot of junk left over if you do that. So there's a tool called App Cleaner, which I talked about in a different video. And then there's this, which will also do much the same thing. And it will do a pretty good job of removing programs completely without, you know, leaving a whole bunch of junk behind. So let's just say if I want to get rid of this Ring program, I can click on uninstall and it will actually go through and remove as much stuff as it can, which is nice. So that is CleanMyMac X. There are other tools out there which will do similar things. You don't need that. But if that's something that interests you, then there you go. It's been set up for you. The screenshot tools built into macOS are pretty good, but they leave something to be desired, especially if you are someone who does a lot of sharing to social media. Maybe you want the perfect size for Facebook or Instagram or Pinterest, whatever the case might be. So for that, there's a tool called Xnapper. And Xnapper is kind of a replacement or supplement to the built-in screenshot tool, which is pretty good still. But what this will do is allow you to automatically resize your images with a background and some cool other visual effects for those different platforms and different uses. So by default with macOS, if you take a screenshot, so if I do Command Shift and 4, I get this window here, which will give me the ability to just gonna draw around what I want to take a screenshot of, or if I do Command Shift 4 and then press space, then I can select the window that I want to take a screenshot of, and it does a pretty good job. And it gives me this nice clean screenshot of that window with no distractions. It's something I can embed in a website or blog article, and it works just fine. But if I want to make this something that's more social website friendly or more shareable, then I can use Xnapper. And by default, the keyboard combination for that is Control Option Command 4, which is kind of a, you know, twister, but you can customize that if you'd like. And that will give me that same crosshairs, which I would have previously, or if I hit space, then I can select the window to take a screenshot of and then click on that. And then it will open this Xnapper window. So if I say auto, then it's just gonna put this nice border around what I wanna take a screenshot of here. Or if I want to automatically size it for, say, Twitter, then I can do that here, or single image tweet, there's that. Or if I want to kind of make it a, you know, a Facebook post, there's the timeline image, and it will automatically set it to be the right resolution for, or the right aspect ratio for these different uses. So if I know that I want to be a 1:1 or 1:1 aspect ratio, I can do that, which is nice for, you know, Instagram and various sites. There's the 4:3, you know, 3:2, 16:9, all very common aspect ratios. Or I can set it to auto to just put that nice border around the window. I can change things here, like the what goes in the background there. So right now it's just gonna use my what I have set for my wallpaper on my background. Or there's the Viola, there's, you know, a few others there. You can also customize and use your own image. You can set your own gradient, which is kind of cool. But this is just a nicer way to create a nice eye-catching image for social media or whatever you wanna do. Now, this is a tool that you can purchase independently if you would like. So if you look at the pricing here, it's $24.99, just the basic for one macOS device, which is not bad, but you can also get this through SetApp. So you can decide if you wanna get it just one-off or if you want to keep paying for it monthly with that subscription, whatever the case might be. So if this is something that you only want this one app, then definitely just pay for it, just be done with it, and you can use it for forever. And that's cool. But if you want to, if you want this to be kind of a value add for that subscription, then honestly, I think this is a compelling offering for SetApp, because this is something that I've used when writing on Medium and in other places, just creating content. So personally, I like it. Maybe you will too. So all these apps are pretty good. And honestly, I think every one of them has a different value proposition. Now, is it worth it to pay a membership fee to get these applications? Maybe, maybe not, depending on your preferences, your budget and what you want to do. I think that there is a case to be made for that, but if you only like, you know, one or two of these applications, then by all means, just go buy those one or two applications. There's no point in paying for a membership fee if you're only going to use one or two, right? But you can go look on the SetApp website and see if there's something else there that you would use. I mean, I'd not even really begun to cover all the apps that are available in the subscription. So there are many more there that you might find useful that I haven't even begun to cover yet. So if that interests you, then definitely check it out. I mean, see if there's something else there that you want, or if you just want that one or two apps, then go buy the one or two apps. There's no point in paying for the monthly membership fee. However, I do think that SetApp is a good option for many people because it gives you a way to get access to a whole bunch of different applications without having to go buy every one of them individually. And then you might decide, you know what, I'm only using like four or five of these, and then go buy those four or five apps and then, you know, get rid of the subscription. So anyway, if you like this video, then please hit that like button and subscribe, and I'll see you in the next video. Thanks.